ideas.
Hello, everybody. Welcome back to the vlog. Hope you are having a pleasant day. As for me, at this time of this recording, it is February 6th, 2023. Hope everybody's doing good. And this is the most anticipated video that I think I've been wanting to make in all my music reviews of Michael Jackson's work. We are at the point where we're going to open up the vault. We're going to look at some of the rarities that have been worked on by Michael in his career. We're going to look at, we're going to listen to snippets of songs that were released on compilation CDs, such as Number Ones, the This Is It soundtrack. We're going to listen to songs that were supposed to be on special edition releases from all the first four albums. Off the Wall, Thriller, Bad, Dangerous. Songs that were worked on that Michael pre-recorded in the studio for a charity event or a anniversary special of some kind or a concert of some kind. We're gonna look at some, we're also gonna look at some music that are still in the vault that got leaked online years ago. And we're also gonna look at, listen to some music that got released, unreleased, I should say, leaked online in the not too recent past. Before I get into all that, I just want everybody to know I'm not doing this for monetary reasons. I'm not doing this to make a buck off it. This is strictly just to look at, listen to Michael's work, what he was planning to do, why it didn't go on a certain album, and my thoughts about it. Before I get into that, I just want to be perfectly clear. I do not approve of people that worked with Michael taking his music and stealing it and basically making a profit out of it. I don't approve of leaking music unless it's going to be eventually released. Like years ago when Michael was still alive, Escape got leaked online. She's Trouble, Sunset Driver. Hi, Jerry. Hold My Hand got leaked. Love Never Felt So Good got leaked. But they all eventually got released one way or another. Most of the songs we're going to listen to in this session are songs that are still unreleased and haven't been released officially. We're also going to listen to different versions of songs that have been released. I mentioned those. A lot of those come on the Michael album and the Escape album. We're going to hear third and even fourth versions of those songs. But I just want to let everybody know, disclaimer, I'm not here to make money off this. I'm just here to play like I did with the album reviews, the 10 seconds of the song. I'll talk about them, how I felt, and what I think Michael was going through. I'll have different sources to go with, whether I look it up on through Google, Wikipedia. And I also found the book that I mentioned in several reviews before that I bought. It's called Man in the Music, The Creative Life and Work of Michael Jackson, which was written by Joseph Vogel. It's this book right here. This is a very good book. This is not the one I want to... There's another one, like the Maestro. It's like thicker than this one, and it's detailed, but I'm not going with that one. So I'm gonna go with this book, and whatever I can't find online, I'm gonna try to find in here, if it's in here. Most of the songs I know that are in the list, I know I have a vague idea of what era and what album they were supposed to be. I got them listed in my media player. I got them in order from the start to the end. I'm going by eras. So that's what I'm going to do with this. So I've rambled on for 4.5 minutes. We're going to get into it right now with the first track. I'm going to kill my Spotify first, because if I hit play, Spotify and Windows Media is going to start playing. And yeah, we're going to start with the first track of this project.
See you.
one of four outtakes from the Thriller session that got cut last minute. This is Hot Street. This song is was by Rod Temperton. And the book here says, a catchy sync pop song. Features cowbell, funky guitar licks, a nice chorus, and Thriller sound and production. This, of the four that I mentioned in Thriller 40, this song, Nightline, which we'll hear next, She's Trouble. And what was the other one? Oh, Carousel. This one's my favorite. I love this song. I wish it was on Thriller 25 and Thriller 40. Hopefully it'll get released someday. This is a cleaner version than what it leaked online many years ago. This version, or the first version of this that leaked online, didn't sound so good. It sounded pretty dirty. Somebody came in, cleaned this up, added a few more things to it, and then repopped it up on YouTube. I like this. This is my favorite of the outtakes of those four. And it's a catchy song. Calling on the nightline, waking me up. Oh, calling on the nightline, can't get enough. Oh, call me on the nightline, whisper in my ear. Call, send it through the pipeline. This is another song of the four I mentioned. This is Nightline. And it was this fun 4.5 minute piece contains strains of soul, R&B, and gospel. This song was written by Glenn Ballard, who worked with Michael on Man in the Mirror and some other songs later on in his lifetime. This one was recorded at Westlake Studios in 1982. I like this song compared to She's Trouble and Carousel. This would be my second favorite. This is another one that somebody took, cleaned it up, and then put back on the internet. The original just did not sound very good. So whoever redid this and uploaded it did an amazing job. And hopefully someday this gets released. This one's a good song. I like this one a lot. I always feel like somebody's watching me. Not so much a rarity, but the fact that it was released on somebody else's album and made it a hit because the King of Pop was on it. Somebody's Watching Me by Rockwell. And Rockwell is the son of Motown founder Berry Gordy. And Rockwell was trying to work on his debut album, and he was going to release it on Motown. And he worked on the song and he gave it to his dad, and his dad didn't like it. He says, go back, you could do better than that. So he was friends with Michael, obviously, because Michael's association with Barry over the years. And so he got Michael to sing the chorus, and Michael did the chorus, and then Rockwell sent the song back to his dad. Didn't tell him Michael was on it, just said, here, check this out. And his dad's like, okay, now it's good. And of course, then he realized who is on the song. According to the liner notes here in the book, it was released on Rockwell's 84 album, Somebody's Watching Me. So the same title. Classic 80s track that reached number 2 on the Hot 100. Michael loved the paranoid anthem when he heard it in the studio and eventually provided vocals for the chorus, although he was intentionally uncredited to avoid label disputes. That was when Michael was at CBS Epic and Rockwell was at Motown. It's a great song. It fits into the horror genre that Michael liked, which I've established many times on this channel. And it was re-released on Michael's Scream Greatest Hits compilation, which was released not too long ago, a few years ago. So this gave Michael another top 10 hit in the mid-1980s. Good song. Love it. In this spot, I was going to play a song called The Man by Paul McCartney. This is the third track that Michael and Paul did together. And unfortunately, it's not letting me play it. And I'm missing another song I was going to play here with the band, but apparently it's not working. I don't know what happened with the man. This is the third track Michael and Paul worked on together. The other one was The Girl Is Mine, and the second one, which we'll get into here next, I'm loading it up as we speak. I'm not a fan of the man. It's not one of my favorites. I just don't care. The man was a duet with Paul McCartney about an enigmatic man who everyone thought they knew. It was blocked as a single by Michael's label to avoid competing with the singles from Thriller. So this song never made the light of day, which I'm fine with because The Girl Was Mine and the next song were much better songs than that one. All alone, I sit home by the phone, I'm waiting for you, baby, baby. Through the years, I can't just stand the year, my place didn't fall. Of all the songs Michael and Paul McCartney collaborated, whether it's the three songs they sang together on or the song Girlfriend on Off the Wall, this one is the best one. I love Say, Say, Say. It's a great song, a great video to it. Michael's sister LaToya appears in it, as well as Paul's wife Linda at the time. This was released in 1983 on Paul's album Pipes and Peace. It was the number one hit in November of 83, co-written by Michael and Paul McCartney. And recorded at Abbey Road Studio with George Martin, the legendary Fifth Beatle. So this song, I think this is probably the only song, as far as I know, that Michael went to London and recorded at the legendary Abbey Roads. Martin said, quote, of Michael, he actually does radiate an aura when he comes into the studio, unquote. Work began on the track in 1981, but was completed 2 years later following the release of Thriller. And the music video was directed by Bob Giraldi, who had previously shot, I believe, the Beat It video for Michael. The video for that, actually, the Say, Say, Say video, was shot in San Ynez Valley, where Michael's ranch, Neverland Valley, is located. So before Michael bought the ranch, he shot the music video with Paul out there and fell in love with the land and bought it. So this is probably it is the best duet between these two. Then I would go Girl Is Mine and then The Man last. And then as far as songs that McCartney gave to Michael, Girlfriend's on the bottom of the totem pole. Not too recent past, Paul released a version of this song with the role switched, where Michael's singing Paul's lines and Paul's singing Michael's lines. So that was kind of interesting. I like that version too, but the original, this version, you can't top it. It's good. And anytime I hear it in the radio, I crank that sucker up. This one was a good one. Mwah. Sing it, Freddy. Let it rip. One of three tracks Michael Jackson worked with the late great Freddie Mercury. This is State of Shock. This was supposed to be the original version after they finished it, of course. This was going to be on originally. According to Freddie in interviews, he was supposed to do some tracks with Michael for Thriller. They never finished. They got him started. There was three tracks they worked on. There was this, There Must Be More to Life Than This, and Victory. And of course, State of Shock and was put on the Jackson's album Victory. Victory was never finished. That still involves. Nobody has heard that. That's been tight-lipped, close to the chest. No word on if that's been finalized or what. It's not in the book here. I'm in the Thriller era of the book, and that one's not listed, but the other two There must be more to life as it's listed, but we'll get into that one next. Oh, right here, State of Shock. Mick Jagger's version. Yeah. So what happened was Michael and Freddie didn't finish the tracks. Michael was finishing up Thriller, and then Queen was going out on tour for their album, so they never got back together to finish it. The Jacksons, each brother did their own song and then brought a bunch to the group, to the table, to pick for the album. And Michael's contribution was State of Shock. And so they got Mick Jagger to do Freddie's vocals, and that's the version that everybody knows today. But it's well known that Michael and Freddie worked together on three tracks, and this was one of them. Jagger did okay, but he doesn't come close to Freddie Mercury. Freddie was awesome. I wish they finished this and released it, and I'd love to hear Victory as well. Nobody knows about Victory. It's never been leaked. It's been stuck in the vault all this time. Whether Queen, the surviving members of Queen, agrees to allow it to be finished, or the Michael Jackson estate, hopefully one day, I think they will, considering the next song eventually got released.
Tending to those crying faces, there must be more to life than living.
Second track between Michael and Freddie Mercury, There Must Be More to Life Than This. There's two versions of this song with Michael. There's three in total. Freddie did this version, did a version of this himself for his album. He released a solo album in the mid-80s. But on this song, this version you heard is the duet between Michael and Freddie. Freddie's playing the piano and doing a beautiful job. And then there's a solo version of Michael just doing the lyrics. I don't remember the year, but it was more recent history. Several years ago, Queen cleaned up and did a whole new version of this song with Freddie and Michael's vocals in it at the with the approval of the Michael Jackson estate. So this song did get released eventually, leaving the other two songs, State of Shock and Victory, unreleased at this time. It's a beautiful song. I love it. I hope Michael's version, this version, gets released someday, maybe as a box set release. I don't know. There's, like I mentioned in a couple videos ago, or a video ago, there's been rumors for years about Michael's estate and Sony possibly doing a duets album. I could see this collaboration being put on a duets album. Everybody knows this song, We Are the World, released on the USA for Africa album. This was a song made for charity to help those in Africa dealing with famine and starvation. Michael Lionel Richie co-wrote the song. Quincy Jones came in to produce it. A star-studded event with the biggest stars of the 1980s, music stars. There's a couple. I want to call them oddballs, but a couple curveballs thrown in there. Dan Aykroyd seen in the back singing. Mostly American performers. This was in response also. This was after Live Aid did their thing with Do They Know It's Christmas. Pretty much the same thing. This was just the American one. And this one did much better than Live Aid. Not that Live Aid was anything bad. Live Aid was very good. I love that. Do They Know It's Christmas and the whole Live Aid concerts. Michael did, of course, that was Michael's spot along with another one later on. Michael does his own line, a second verse which the second verse where Michael sings, "When you're down and out and there seems no hope at all," that was actually supposed to be Prince singing that part, but Prince decided not to show up, even though he donated a song to the charity album. There's a Prince song on there. Prince didn't show up. Quincy Jones basically sent the memo out to everybody and had a note on the door when everybody showed up. Check your egos at the door. He didn't want anybody coming in power tripping. He wanted this all to be, everybody to be in harmony, and this is for a good event, and just don't be an ass, pretty much. And Prince, he was an ass, and he didn't show up, which is unfortunate, because I think Prince, I would love to hear Prince sing a line on here. So Michael sang his line, and then towards the end of the song, when they're singing the chorus over and over, you can hear Michael's famous hoo-hoos in the background. Beautiful song. It made a lot of money for the longest time. For many, many, many years, it was the biggest selling single of all time. There is a version of this on the Ultimate Collection of Michael just singing the whole song by himself, which I did not cover because we just did this world one here instead. It's a good uplifting song, and this was the start of Michael's anthems that he started putting on each of his albums up until the day he died. This was the granddaddy of the anthems. So this little ditty is called Bumper Snippet, and it's believed to have been worked on during the bad/dangerous days. I'm trying to find info in this book about it. Nothing in the bad album section, so I'm fast forwarding here to the dangerous section. I do remember when they were announcing the special edition releases in 2001. When Dangerous was going to be a two-disc set, they were going to put Bumper Snippet on the disc two, and I remember seeing that track listing, and while it was a short track listing, I do remember Bumper Snippet, but as I'm looking in here, it's not coming up. So it's believed to be a bad/dangerous era. I would say probably dangerous, since it was scheduled to be on the special edition, which it got canceled. It's still laying in the vault, but it got put online years ago. That's basically what we just heard.
You were there before we came. You took the hurt. You took the shame. They built the walls to block your way. You beat them down. You won the day.
This was a special performance Michael did for Sammy Davis Jr. Sammy Davis, it was a birthday celebration for Sammy, and Michael was one of Sammy's favorites. This is in the recorded 1989, never released. A gorgeous ballad written by Michael and Buzz Cohen. Michael and Buzz worked a lot together. Michael's performance of this at Sammy's 60th anniversary show at the Shrine in 1989. So this was made pre-dangerous, post-bad. So this is around when Decade started being worked on. And I remember the 2001 track listing for the special edition of Dangerous. This was listed as a release. It's too bad because I love the song. This is one of Michael's best live performances. This was recorded in the studio, and then he did the playback. But it's one of his finer moments. Sammy Davis at the end, of course, Michael went to him. Sammy sitting front and center, down front, gave him a hug. They were good friends. And sadly, shortly after this, we lost Sammy Davis. What a living legend he was, along with Michael. I love Sammy. He is funny as hell. My favorite movie role of Sammy Davis is, it's got to be Cannonball Run. I mean, he's just, with him and Dean Martin, the Rat Pack. I loved him in Ocean's 11, the original, back in the 60s. That's a great movie. If you ever want to look at a good movie, don't watch the George Clooney one, which is good in its own right, but go watch the original Ocean's 11 with Frank Sinatra and the Rat Pack. Sammy did a good job, singed in it. But Cannonball Run, he was so funny. I love the scene where they're putting the bet on themselves for the race. They're in Vegas, and they're talking to Jimmy the Greek, and they're talking about God will be our co-pilot. And Dean Martin's like, have you seen our car? It's got two seats. Where's he going to sit? Smacks him. Where's he going to sit? And then the other one's when they're being pulled over by a cop. And the cop called Sammy Shorty, and he looked at Dean. He says, did he call me Shorty? And Dean's like, yeah, because you're small. S-M-all. I love it. Just those little lines and throughout the whole movie. The whole movie cast was great. But Sammy Davis, what a legend. He was so funny. He was so good. And he is missed a lot. He is seriously missed. So this song, Serious Effect, we're in the dangerous era now. This is the one where Michael worked with LL Cool J. LL was just coming up. And this was worked on, co-written by Michael and Teddy Riley. So this is the very early Teddy Riley workings of Dangerous. This is when they started going to the new Jack. For whatever reason, this got left off the album. I like it. I hope it's released someday. LL Cool J's lyrics are good. It's not rap. It's more hip-hop-ish. You can understand them. They're good. I like this song. It's fresh and sounds really good. Should have been released.
Maybe the walls will tumble and the sun may refuse to shine. When I say I love you, maybe you gotta know that's for all time. Maybe you gotta know that's for all time.
One of my absolute favorite tracks, this song, recorded in 1982. It was released on Thriller 25 in 2008. I always thought all these years it was a Dangerous outtake and then put on that album by mistake, but apparently I was wrong. But nonetheless, a pretty ballad originally written by Steve Porcaro from Toto fame, David Pinch, and Michael Sherwood. It was re-recorded during the Danger sessions, but left off the final cut for the album as well. It was finally released as a bonus track for Thriller 25. Why it wasn't put back on Thriller for 40, I don't know. It should have been re-released. I love the song. It's beautiful. It's uplifting. This has always been one of my favorite unreleased tracks that finally got released. When I first heard this online, this was early 2000s when I first heard this. I was blown away by this song, and I was pining for this song to be released. It should have been released on Michael's last three albums. Dangerous should have been released on History, should have been released on Invincible. And finally, it got released on Thriller 25, but it got lost in the shuffle of the remixes and didn't get the promotion it deserves. They need to re-release this, get a video out, and put it on the radio. It would be a hit song. This is my absolute favorite. And in fact, when I married my second wife, this was our dance, our first dance. I picked this song. She liked it, and so we danced to this one. If I go back and change it though, because of what happened with me and her, I probably would change the song. Because there's other songs from my first marriage that are tainted and I don't listen to now, but this song, I still listen to it because I love it so much. But this is a great song. Should have been released as a single. Should have been on Dangerous. I think it would have made that album a whole lot better than it already is. And even History or Invincible, this would have fit just fine. This is the song I mentioned before, If You Don't Love Me. I do not like this song. I don't like it. I never liked it. Written by Michael and produced by Bill Petrell, this infectious retro rock soul number recalls the sound of 60s classics such as Do You Love Me and It Takes Two. Jackson delivers an outstanding vocal performance on this fun, unique, yet to be discovered gem, unquote. I disagree. I get the feeling this feels like a rejected boy band song. A lot of fans like this one. I'm in the minority. I do not like this song. I rank this up there with Girlfriend and the demo version of Love Never Felt Good as worst tracks ever. I'm sorry. I don't like it. It was scheduled to be on the special edition release that got canceled. I'm glad it's in the vault, and I honestly hope it stays there, because if it's put on an album, it's going to be an instant skip for me. So this song is Men in Black. This is one of the rarities that got leaked online not too long ago. This was one that's been in the vault since the Dangerous Sessions, the fans knew of, but never heard it until it got leaked online. The track has long been the subject of speculation among fans. Michael recorded a demo in 1990 with Brian Lauren, but it was left off the final lineup of Dangerous. This was supposed to be on the canceled special edition release. This is one fans have been wanting for years. Hopefully it gets released. The leaked version you just heard was from YouTube. Doesn't sound very good. I'm sure the actual version that's in the vault or with whomever sounds good. It's from what you can understand and what I can hear, I like where it's heading, and hopefully it gets released someday. I think it'd be a good track to listen to. Lisa, it's your birthday. God bless you this day. So this is one of two songs Michael wrote for the Simpsons soundtrack. This is Lisa, It's Your Birthday. This appeared in the episode Stark Raven Dad, which Michael lent his voice to. Didn't sing this song in the show because of contractual obligations. But this version is Michael, and it is on the soundtrack. Michael also wrote Do the Bartman, which he didn't sing on, and I'm not going to showcase because he didn't sing it. Beautiful song. Not sure if this was going to be on the special edition release. I think they could release it, maybe on a box set. Beautiful song. I love it. And anybody that's named Lisa and they get this played for their birthday, happy birthday. Beautiful production. I love this song. Mind is a Magic. This is the single version. It's shorter. The long version's like 5-6 minutes long. I love this song. I wish it was on Dangerous. Worked on in 1989, unreleased. still in the vaults today. Well, I take that back. It's on the Siegfried and Roy soundtrack. They released an album, and Michael lent this to him. He's a big Magic fan. Seen them a lot in Vegas. This is a Brian Lauren tune that was early on thought to be on Dangerous and then got cut when they went with Teddy. It's too bad because this is a good song. It sounds good to this day. I like it. Hopefully the longer version or even this version gets put on an album someday. So it's released under Michael's name. It's a good song. Michael did a good job. That's one thing I noticed about Michael, and especially when he went into the 90s, he had a lot of big productions, and this is no exception. Oh yeah, I like this outtake from the Dangerous Sessions. This song's called She's Got It. She Got It. And the writing on this is a funk rock groove reminiscent of 80s era Prince. Co-written with Bill Petrell and Teddy Riley, it features a driving guitar riff and funky beat. This is a good song. I kind of like this more than I do the three weak ones on Dangerous that I mentioned. Why You Want a Trip, She's Driving Me Wild, and Can't Let It Get Away. I think this would have fit really good on Dangerous. This was another one that was scheduled to be on the special edition release and got canceled. This is a good song. I hope it gets released someday. I can hear the Prince influence in it. It's funky. That's something Prince would have done. It talks about a girl who's got it. That's up Prince's alley. So, beautiful track. Good track. Love it. Wish it was on the album.
Hey, girl.
My only wish is to satisfy you.
Hey, yeah, yeah.
I wanna make this the best I can do.
Hey,
to keep you happy,
girl,
with all my might.
Yeah.
You're one for nothing, both day and night.
So, Satisfy You was a Dangerous era song worked on. Didn't get completed as far as anyone's aware of. Eventually, Brian Lauren, who wrote this song with Michael, recorded himself, and what you heard was Michael's vocals on the chorus. I would like to see, I'd like to hear a version of Michael's, if there's one in the vault, of just Michael singing it. It's a great song. Maybe they could do this one as a single on a duets album. This had potential. This was your classic 90s romance song. I like it. I wish it was on the album. Or at least I wish it would get released. I'd like to hear the other version of this, if there is one. Another funky-driven song from the 1990s, co-written by Michael and Brian Lauren. Another Brian Lauren track which got left off. Michael sings the famous lines from the Jackson 5 hit ABC. Sit down, girl, I think I love you. No, get up, girl, show me what you can do. He sings that in the bridge. This is a good song. I would rank this lower, though, than the last two songs. Last few songs, actually. For the Dangerous Sessions. It's still good. I wouldn't mind seeing it released. It was supposed to be on disc 2 of the special edition, but didn't. It's definitely 90s dated, but it's still a good song. Wouldn't mind seeing it on an album.
Remember the time when I was alone. You stood by my side and said, let's be strong. You did all these things.
I love you. The world knows your worth. Now I'm falling.
Beautiful tribute song Michael did for Elizabeth Taylor at her 65th birthday celebration. Elizabeth, I love you. Much like you are, you were there. Michael recorded it in the studio and then came to perform it live on stage. Tore the house down. Michael came out, started the song. There's a scene at the beginning where Michael does a little he does a little curtsy, and this little girl comes out. We're assuming that's young Elizabeth. Crowd starts laughing. Well, Michael put that shit to rest in a hurry. By the end of the song, Michael does I'll pray one day I'll be just like. He does a spin. Boom! Poses, and the spotlight hits him, and the crowd just erupts. And then he sings "Like You," and he holds the "You" line at least 20 seconds longer, maybe. Finishes the song to a big orchestra. Dun, 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 dun. Bam! Song's over. Michael's doing this. Crowd just goes nuts. And they're on their feet. Just what a performance. One of his best tributes to his best friend, Elizabeth Taylor. I've heard the studio version of this without the crowd noise. It is very good. I don't think this was ever planned to be on any albums. I don't remember seeing this on being listed on anything. This was made after History was out, but I think it should be put out. It's a beautiful, if not the audio, put this performance on a DVD set of all of Michael's best performances, because this is up there. This is one of the best he's ever done. So this is the track that was supposed to be track 8 on History Disc 2, but didn't make it. It was a beautiful song. Michael recorded "Why" for the History album, written by Babyface. But when Michael's nephews, 3T, heard it, 3Ts are the son of Tito. He gave it to them for their debut album, Brotherhood. However, they left Michael's vocals on the chorus, so what you just heard was Michael's original chorus. It's believed there is a solo version of this still in the vaults. Some people said there is. There's others that are claiming there isn't. It's just Michael singing this part. I would tend to agree that there is something on there, because if it was considered for History and then cut at like last minute, I'm genuinely believing that there is a full version of this. And if there is, I hope it gets released someday. It's a beautiful song. It should have been released on History. Beautiful duet with a beautiful track by his nephews 3T. This is "I Need You." Michael only appears in that part of the song. This was a song that they did for their mother. It was a tribute to their mother. Their mother had died in a drowning accident. And so they did that on their Brotherhood album for her. And they got Michael to do the last line there. It's a touching tribute. After Michael had passed, 3T had gotten, they hadn't worked on anything for a long time. And so they went on a tour, and then they did a TV special where they did all their hits, and this as well as Why. They performed in knocked it out of the park. Crowd went nuts, tears flowing. After everything that happened with Michael and his death, this song, as you can tell and hear from me talking, it hit home. It's one of those tear jerkers because you think of Michael, and it's a good song. I really wish there's a version of this with Michael singing the whole thing, but I doubt it. This was definitely made for 3T, but it just makes your mind wander. Did Michael record a version of this for himself? That would be something special to hear, I think. Michael's tribute song for September 11th tragedy. This is What More Can I Give. This is in the vein of We Are the World. This is a good song. Michael started working on this in late 90s, but it got held back. He recorded it in 1998 and then again in 2001, and then released it in 2001 as a digital download. First used for Nelson Mandela charity concerts, the Michael Jackson and Friends What More Can I Give concerts. Those are the ones I mentioned in the last video. Michael was doing a show in Germany, and he was on the stage doing his set for Earth Song when the top of the bridge crashed down and screwed up Michael's back. A whole bunch of artists that were singing at those events came on stage with Michael to sing it. But then it was re-recorded to benefit families of the victims of September 11th. One version features just Jackson on vocals, while the other features Beyonce, Celine Dion, Mariah Carey, among others. It's a beautiful song. It got released. Unfortunately, it didn't get released right away. Michael's battle with Sony didn't help matters with it. But it got released. It eventually was the video for it, the recording of it was released, debuted at an awards show on NBC, and it received positive feedback. It's certainly not up there with We Are the World, but it's for a good cause, and Michael did an amazing job. I think Michael should have done an album like We Are the World, USA for Africa, have a bunch of different artists pick different songs of theirs that they wanted to contribute along with this. I think that's what they should have did with Cry single from Michael's Invincible. They should have put Cry on that and then put a different song on Invincible instead. But, you know, it's just, you can say that all well and good now, but you can't go back. You can't get in a time machine and fix things, unfortunately. But I love What More Can I Give. It was, it's a good song. Shout, hold my hands up and shout. What is this that is all about? Oh, this makes me wanna shout. This is the song I mentioned in the Invincible sessions. This is Shout. I love the song. I don't understand why they kicked it off the album for You Are My Life. I love You Are My Life. This should have stayed on the album. They should have kicked off one of the weaker tracks for it. This is a rock hip-hop adaptation of the Isley Brothers' 1959 hit by the same name. I mentioned it was Otis Day and the Nights originally. Isley Brothers. Rather than celebrating like the original, Michael raps some intense lyrics over a jagged beat and screaming guitar, quote, living in caged like animals and cannibals, unquote, he says in one verse. quote, eating each other alive just to survive the 9-to-5, unquote. You got that right. It was scheduled to be on Invincible until the final month when Michael decided to replace it with You Are My Life. I think that was a big mistake. He should have left it on the album and replaced one of the other ones like Heartbreaker, the title track Invincible, or Privacy. Hell, you can replace this with Invincible and rename the album Shout. And it goes with Michael's one line title tracks, but whatever. It did get a release as a B-side on the Cry single, but didn't do anything. It's still a B-side release to this day. I think, like, Escape, I think they could use this as a title track for a future posthumous album. This song sounds good, even to this day. I mean, it's been 22 years, or will be 22 years, since Invincible came out, and this song still sounds great. They need to release this. This damn good song. Michael did a great job on it. This is the song One More Chance, originally worked on in 2001, was withheld from Invincible. They went with Cry instead. This is the third R. Kelly track worked on with Michael, third and final R. Kelly track. There may be more, we're not sure, but this was the third one released. This was released on Number Ones. I like this song. I think actually this would have fit nicely on Invincible. It was the whole comeback album. But it was left off. It's great. It's a great song. The video was shot in Las Vegas. And unfortunately, two things happened with that video shoot. Number one, while he was shooting that in 2003, that's when the second allegations started coming out and police raided Neverland Ranch and did a search warrant. And it also is the final music video Michael shot in his lifetime. A lot of people don't know this. They think he shot other music videos. He shot videos of him in the studio with other artists, but he didn't do any more music videos, except for his This Is It stuff he shot for that, but I don't really count that.
Planet Earth, my home, my place, a capricious anomaly in the sea of space. Planet Earth, are you just floating by, a cloud of dust, a minor globe about to bust, a piece of metal bound to rust.
One of a couple songs on his This Is It soundtrack. This was released after his death. This was put as a demo on disc 2. There's a 2-disc set. This is beautiful. This is just Michael talking a poem. And I hope there's more of this stuff in the vaults. Michael released a book in the early 90s called Dancing the Dream. And it's a book, and it's got different poems and stuff. And I believe this is in that book. I'm not sure, but I'm positive it is, but this is beautiful. You just hear Michael just talking a story, and it's an amazing track. It's a 3-minute, 15-second track. Just Michael reading this beautiful poem that he penned. I hope there's more. I hope he did that with his other Dancing the Dream poems and writings. I think that would be something special to hear. This is a different thing for Michael. Michael didn't do this before. He's done, he did a cappella stuff before. He did the a cappella for the beginning and ending of Speechless. But an actual poem is just amazing. He did the voice over for the E.T. storybook. I would love to hear this. The rest of these Dancing the Dream poems on album. I think it would be so good. Or even an audiobook. of Dancing the Dream. If Michael had done that with all his tracks, I think that'd be cool. The title track of the ill-fated This Is It concert. This Is It was released on the compilation CD. This was a song that was worked on with his brothers. They did this as a release after his passing. I'm trying to find info on that in this book, but I'm not seeing it. Which is a shame, because I could have sworn it was in here. So I'm looking in the back. So anyways, this song was worked on. This was originally written by Paul Anka. This was originally done in the early 80s, and then his brothers worked on it together on this version, and there's an orchestra version of the same song. I like it. It's a good song. It does get to you when you think about this is the first song post death that was put out there. This was released, I think, before the Michael album. It's a shame. It's a good song, and I wish it was promoted a little heavier. This song, originally entitled She Was Loving Me, renamed to Chicago for the Escape album. This is the fourth version of this song. It's the third version of the song. Yes, third version. The contemporized version, which appears on Escape, as well as Michael's demo version from the 90s. This is the third version, and I think this is the best version. One of his nephews from 3T produced this version. Put it online, and it's become an instant fan favorite. I love it. They should have released this instead, I think. I think it would have been a great hit song. This is one of Michael's best songs that he's ever done. The way he sings it, when you listen to it in the other versions, you could feel, especially the chorus, this was meant to be a rock song. And his nephew made it into a rock song, and this just fits the lyrics like a glove. No pun intended, Michael being the gloved one. This version's badass. And you held out, you said no, you stand up. Only God knows that it's all in the game. It's all in your name. Carry me to the gates of paradise as a slave. It's all in your name. This is such a beautiful song. I love this. Barry Gibb from the Bee Gees. Great friends with Michael over the years. Michael was a big Bee Gees fan. He got to be friends with all of them. This was originally unreleased. This was worked on the early 2000s. After Michael's death, it was finally released as a non-album single. There's video footage of Michael and Barry recording this in the studio. This is believed to be the final collaboration Michael did before his passing. Whether that's true or not is unconfirmed, but a lot of people say this was the final collaboration Michael did as a duet. It's a beautiful song. I love it. Would love to hear Michael, another version with all Michael. I don't think there is any. When I first heard it, when it was finally released online, I was just blown away. And then when Michael's voice came out, just hitting the falsetto and just he was back. It was this is a song that gets you. But you hear Michael's angelic voice. It's a damn good song, and I'm glad that Barry finished it and released it as tribute to Michael.
Look what you done to me, baby. I can no longer smile, baby. And I waited so long just to carry on. I'm the blue gig
So now we're getting into the tracks the other versions of tracks that made the Escape album or were left off the Escape album for other different tracks. This is the 2010 version of Blue Gangsta. Actually, the next three tracks, including this one, are all alternate versions of songs that got released eventually on Escape. This version here was originally scheduled to be on the Michael album. As you heard the Old West sound effect in the background, that was added to this. This is the original demo of Michael's, just cleaned up a little bit, some added stuff. Otherwise, this is the way Michael had it when he released it, when he worked on it originally. I love Blue Gangsta. It should have been on Invincible. This is a song they released for Escape. They did a video for this for Cirque du Soleil, and they did this version rather than the album version, the contemporized version. This is the version I would have put on the album, along with the first part of the contemporized version. I would have gone into I would play that part first, up until where he says, "I'm the Blue Gangsta," and then you go in the first chorus, then I would have gone into this song. Because that opener for that song was awesome, and then it went, once it kicked up a notch, it went to crap. But this version, I love this one. They should have just had this one as the contemporized version. So this is the third version for Do You Know Where Your Children Are that was featured on Escape, the contemporized version, and then Michael's version from the Dangerous Sessions. Would have likely been a big hit had it been included on Dangerous. Michael held on to it thinking it wasn't quite ready, but having in mind to use it for a future album, features a fierce guitar riff and an instant memorable chorus. Like other tracks on Dangerous, the song is keenly attuned to real-world issues, tackling neglect, exploitation, and sexual abuse. This version is totally different from Michael's original demo and the contemporized version. I think the contemporized version they put on Escape just butchered the hell out of the song. This version, the 2010 version, which was meant for the Michael album, is so much better in my opinion. The guitar riff in the bridge is awesome. They should have used this one. I like this version compared to Michael's demo and the 2013-14 Escape version. The third of four versions of Slave to the Rhythm. This is the version I mentioned in the Escape album review that I think should have made the album instead because of the bridge. I just played you guys the bridge. When I hear Michael sing that bridge in the contemporized version or his original demo version from the Dangerous Sessions, it doesn't feel like a bridge. But here in this version, it feels like a bridge. This is classic vintage Michael. Whoever did this for 2010 did an amazing job. This should have been on Escape. It was supposed to be on Michael album. Classic vintage Michael Jackson sound. There's some hard ows and whoos at the end that just, ooh, yeah. There's a fourth version of the song I'll just do a little ditty about it because I forgot to talk about an Escape. When Escape was being worked on, it wasn't out yet, Justin Bieber came out and claimed he had worked on a track for Michael Jackson and he was going to release it. And it leaked online. It was a duet featuring Justin Bieber and Michael Jackson. And it got shit on right away. Fans rejected it. They hated it. And then Michael's estate and Sony came out and said, no, you're not doing this. You had no permission to do this. You're not on this album. He's not featured. They basically did a cease and desist. So there is a fourth version of this with Biebs. It's awful. I've heard it. It's trash. The fact that he basically lied and said, I'm working on the Michael Jackson album, and then he stole one of Michael's songs and butchered the shit out of it. Just for that alone, he should be deported back to Canada. But whatever. I'm glad that one's... I don't even own that one. I don't even have that in my collection. I have never downloaded it, and I refuse to download it. That's... Okay, I rank that as the absolute worst Michael song. Biebs version. That's worse than Girlfriend. I'd rather listen to Girlfriend for 8 hours straight than listen to Bieber sing that song and ruin a damn good song. So Bieber, fuck you. Now we're getting into the nitty-gritty of some of the tracks that were worked on for Invincible and after, up until Michael's death. So I'm going to go by what I just know and have read over the years, because it's not in this book. Most of the next few tracks to the end here are not in that book. Days in Gloucestershire is a song he worked on. It was leaked online several years ago. This is a beautiful track. It's incomplete, but I can see this being released on like a box set, like the Ultimate Collection. Or there might be another version, a full version of it online. It's a beautiful song. I wish it would get released, whether it's as is or in a different setting, as long as nobody does too much to it. I think it's beautiful the way it is, and Michael did a great job about this song.
Never land. We can kiss the moon and worship on a distant star. I could see the future over us as distant promises.
This is one of a couple songs that got leaked online not too long ago, within the last month. It's called Dream Away. I'm not going to touch on this very long because it was illegally leaked online. Hi, Jerry. This was leaked along online, along with another song we're going to get to, right before Thriller 40 dropped. I like it. The version of this that's on YouTube isn't the greatest sound. Somebody recorded this during a In the Studio seminar. And you could tell the quality is not the greatest. I like the song. It's got potential. Of all the tracks that have been leaked online for many years now, it's okay. It's not high on my list, but I'd be interested in hearing a CD quality version of it. It definitely had potential. It's a cute little track.
Here in Chicago, 1945, Cubs lost that year, but Al Capone was found alive. They searched 40 days in the suburbs of the night.
So this is a song that leaked online not too long ago, illegally. Somebody stole these from one of Michael's producers that was doing a seminar, and this got leaked online. This was leaked around Thriller 40 release. and then the fresh version that you just heard was leaked online because of the theft. This is a song that's been in the vault for many, many years. A lot of fans have been wanting to hear this and finally have a chance to. I hope it does get released despite the fact it's been leaked. It's a good song. It's good production. This was done around Bad Thriller era in that area. It's a great song. This is called Chicago 1945. This has nothing to do with the other Chicago that appears on Escape. That was She Was Loving Me, a whole different song, and Sony decided to change the name of the song for whatever stupid reason. But this track is actually named Chicago. I love it. It's got a good feel to it, and I think this would have been I can understand why it was left off maybe Thriller. It doesn't feel like a Thriller track. This feels more like Bad era. Probably could have been thrown on disc 2 or 3 if it was still going to be a triple set like they were starting to plan. This is a good song. I hope it gets released someday. This song is my cat continues to meow and won't shut up. The song's called We Be Ballin'. This was a song that was believed to be offered to Michael for the Invincible Sessions, and Michael recorded some vocals, but it never got finished. It was eventually given to Ice Cube, and Shaquille O'Neal is on there as well. You can hear Michael singing a little bit in the chorus, We Be Ballin'. It's decent. I'm not an Ice Cube fan, but it's a good song. It's a hip-hop-ish. You can understand what they're singing. Definitely has that Invincible feel to it, but I'm glad it got left off the album because that whole thing with Rodney Jerkins just... I'm sorry, that's not Michael's style. This is this song is the Invincible era outtake. This is Can't Get Your Weight Off of Me. This is a song that a lot of fans are interested in hearing. I put this in the bin with Heartbreaker and Invincible and Privacy. It's one of the absolute worst tracks from the sessions. I don't have any interest in this. It's more of the same crap that Rodney Jerkins brought to the table and a lot of overrated crap. I don't like this song. Songs like Shout, We've Had Enough are a hell of a lot better than this song. So, not a big fan of this one at all.
Let us dream of tomorrow where our children are nurtured and protected and nourished and our elders revered and honored and venerated. Let us dream of peace and harmony and laughter. Let us dream of joy and ecstasy. Let us dream of dancing the cosmic dance. And as we dream, let us remember those who dare to dream before us and sacrifice their yesterday so we could have our tomorrow.
Song that got leaked online not too long ago, Faces. I love this song. It had potential. It didn't get finished. What you heard here at the end before I faded out is pretty much what's left. Michael with a spoken intro for several minutes. I put this in the bin of Earth Song in that vein. Not so much about negative stuff, more about positivity and let us dream and all this stuff. I like this song. I think it's got potential. Maybe it's finished. We don't know. This is just over 6 minutes long. Hopefully it gets released someday, whether it's on a box set, new album, whatever. It's got... You could release it the way this is now, but the ending part where there's no vocals at all, you could get somebody else to come in and do something if they got lyrics to it. Do a collaboration of Michael plus whoever. I think that would be something I could see them doing and would be fine with that. But it's a beautiful song. Michael did a fantastic job.
I don't care even if it's wrong or right. It's a family thing. It's a family thing. Wake the dead, stir me deep into the night. It's a family thing. It's a family thing.
This was originally intended for the Addams Family movie in the 90s. Michael wanted to be... I think I heard Michael wanted to be a part of that, but it ended up not happening. I put this in the horror genre. Not so much horror, but like his other songs, but kind of in that trajectory. It's a decent song. I like it. Wouldn't mind seeing this released on an album someday. It feels like a complete version in spots, but at the beginning, he's just going, da-da-da, da-da-da. Dun, 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 dun. So it's one of those songs where he didn't finish. He just was kind of playing with songs in his mind, and then he went into the lyrics, and yeah. So it's good. It's a decent song. Maybe there's another one out there. I hope there's one out there somewhere. It's got potential.
You laughed at me. You made me cry. You made a joke and wonder why
I am a loser.
So the story behind this, from what I heard, was one of the producers he worked with was going through a separation. He goes to meet Michael at his hotel, and he's just using Michael's shoulders to cry on, and he kept singing, the guy kept saying, "I'm such a loser, I'm a loser," and Michael's like, "Well, let's sing about it." Michael just got that line in his head, and they wrote it out. And here you go. I am a loser. There's actually another version of this song. Michael singing, "I was either a loser or the loser, but I am the loser." It's a decent song. It's cute. So Michael's not talking about his personal experience, but somebody else's in this case. And it was one of his producers. I don't remember which one it was. Which producer? I'll have to go and look at that one, but it's a cute little song. This song was a song that Michael started working on, I think, in the Dangerous the History sessions. I'm going to look it up. I think it might be in here. This is a beautiful song, and from what I remember reading about this in the news articles, it's listed in the book as an unreleased track, so I'll have to go find where it's at. 228. This song was supposed to be a charity event song. I remember the news articles about this, and Michael was working on a song called "I Have This Dream." Oh yeah, it was during the Invincible sessions, so I'm gonna be able to find it. Oh, well, maybe not right there. I'm gonna have to go for right here. Okay, so recorded in 1999, and it's still unreleased to this day. It was leaked online. A new millennium anthem Jackson was working on with David Foster and Carol Baysager. So he worked with Carol quite a bit. It was talked about quite a bit before Invincible was released, but ultimately failed to make the album. So yeah, what happened, I remember this now, it's all coming back to me. It's amazing what just listening to one thing and reading about something triggers your memory. Michael was supposed to do Millennium Concerts at the turn of the century on January January 2000, December 31st, 1999. He was supposed to do a set of concerts, including one on New Year's Eve into 2000. And he was supposed to do something with that song. And he backed out of it. He got sued over it and blah, blah, blah. But this is a beautiful song. I mentioned before how if they were to go in and finish a song that Michael had started in vain of We Are the World, something like that, with his other artists singing on it, including Michael's vocals with it, I would have no problem with that. This is no exception, and another song we're going to hear to close out the set here in a little bit. And even Faces, if they were to get some people to come in and do other lines of the song that aren't recorded by Michael, I'd be fine with it. I Have This Dream, it's so beautiful. It's a 5-minute and 8-second track. It's unfinished, but it sounds so good. I'd have no problems if somebody were to get some vocals on this, whether it's other artists or just a artist with just Michael. This song needs to be released. It's a good one. Michael had a vision for it, obviously, but never got to finish it. I think this would be a great charity event song.
I sing of what you see and might think about because of what you see. Moving hands, mobile faces, whereby the eye, not the ear, traces.
Song called Seeing Voices, featuring the Ray Charles Choir. This was another one of those big production songs Michael was working on at that time, along with I Have This Dream, Faces, and the song we're going to play here in a couple songs later. It's beautiful. I think this is another one they could probably get other people to come in and do, along with Michael's vocals. It's beautiful. There's a nice piano playing at the beginning and some choir and stuff. Something I didn't mention before in other videos, and I just remembered this. I mentioned that Michael was working on a album in the mid-2000s. After everything happened with the criminal investigation and the court case, and he was found not guilty, after everything simmered down, Michael decided to go get out of the country, get out of the spotlight, just get himself in shape. He went everywhere. He went other places, Bahrain, he went to Ireland, I don't remember some other places, but he went to record music. He was working on an album. He was actually considering doing two albums, and the second album he wanted to do was an instrumental album, an orchestra type. And I think this is kind of in the vein of where he was going for that. He really wanted to get into doing an album like Mozart, Beethoven, guys like that. And it's believed there are some stuff he did start working on that are in the vault still. But since that news about an orchestra album has come out, since Michael's passing, nothing has been said about a possible album like that. It would have been interesting. It would have been something Michael never done before. I certainly would be interested in hearing something like that. I don't know how well it would do. I think it would do better than a freaking remix album that he had no intentions of doing, even though he got forced to do it. I think hearing a instrumental album from Michael would have been interesting, and I think it would be okay. I think the fans, I don't think it would have commercial success. I think this would be more of a fan thing. So I don't think a commercial success, they'd be expecting it, but something to have in the Michael Jackson archives would be something interesting to have. So this is another track that was leaked online and not in the best of quality. This song called Throwing Your Life Away. This was done around Bad Era, Dangerous. It's a decent song. It's another song that's not finished. You can tell in certain parts there's vocals missing, but I would love to hear a clean version of this song. I think it's got potential. It's really too bad that some of these songs got leaked the way they did, because I know Michael wouldn't have been happy about it. He wasn't happy about it when it happened with Escape and Hold My Hand, but they did eventually get released, especially Hold My Hand, according to his wishes. They had a bunch of papers they found in his bedroom after his death. They had a whole list of different song titles, and one of them was Hold My Hand, and specifically wrote to be the first single released, and they did it. Throwing Your Life Away, it's got potential. I'd like to hear a full version of it. I hope it comes out someday. It's a good song, but obviously in this state, it's not the best sounding one. Beautiful song, People of the World. Wrap up this video and this look back at Michael's career and what he left us and what's out there to possibly be given to us, the fans. People of the World, this is one of my favorites. It's uplifting. It's an anthem. This needs to be finished and released right now. With everything going on in the world right now, with Corona, with the upheaval, with our governments fighting each other, we need a good anthem. I mentioned that with On the Line. I mentioned it with We've Had Enough, and this one's no exception. This is another song that's incomplete, but you can still hear Michael in spots, including the chorus, and there's a nice, beautiful choir at the end. I would be fine with them bringing other artists in to sing to different lines to finish the song, as long as they leave everything else alone with Michael's vision of what he wanted to do for this song. I would, even in its state right now, this is better than Cry. I like this better than Cry, and I like Cry. It's a good song. I wouldn't rank this higher than On the Line or We've Had Enough, but it's in that group. It's a beautiful song, and I think Michael would have eventually gotten this finished and released. And I think it would be a good anthem, especially in this time of need with everything going on in the world. And I hope and pray it does get released and it becomes a worldwide hit. Because it's just got some beautiful lyrics and just it's a good anthem. So that's it. That's all I got. There are other songs out there, but don't have access to them. There's some other songs out there that could be out there that I might have missed, and forgive me for that. I only have so much stuff that I can find and do. Like I said at the beginning of this video, well over an hour ago, I had no ill intentions of anything about playing these songs, especially the ones that were leaked in shady situations. I had nothing to do with those things. I'm just a fan. I love Michael's music, and I like looking back at what he was going through at the time and seeing what could have been. And I hope eventually all this stuff gets released the right way, and Michael's creation can live on through our lifetime and our children's lifetime. He is one of the greatest singer, songwriters, and entertainers of our generation, of all time, of all mankind. He will be studied for hundreds of years, if not thousands, and he left his mark on the music industry. You can't deny that, whether you like his music or not. He is one of the
if not the greatest of all time. I had a great time going through each and every one of his songs. I'm looking forward to going back and starting over again and listening to music again. And I hope you guys enjoyed these reviews of his albums and now the unreleased stuff, the rare stuff. There's a lot more where that came from, though. I'm sure there's more songs we haven't heard yet. We just heard a couple of them on the Thriller 40 that we never heard before. All things are possible moving forward. If you like this episode, hit the like button. Leave a comment if you like. Subscribe to the channel. If you'd like to help out with future projects, please visit my Patreon at patreon.com/mntwins28. You don't have to help, but any help, always greatly appreciated. Until next time, peace out.